Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. This is Muhammad Salim, Associate Professor of Children and Adolescents. First of all, we ask ourselves, psychiatry is not about craziness, but about the problems we have, cognition and attention and concentration, memory and so on. Who is a normal child? Every child is unique and so on. What's normal is a range. Child psychiatric assessment requires this is just to say that psychiatric disorders, and also we have in adolescence, they are even more prevalent. And worldwide, only about 10% of affected children receive psychiatric. We will talk in this lecture about the intellectual disabilities that we have in children. That's ID. ADHD, the attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, autism spectrum disorder, disruptive behavior disorders, and some few points about anxiety and mood disorders in children and adolescents. We start with the intellectual disability. As we all know, the degree of intelligence or the intelligence quotient might vary from one person to the other. And most of the individuals, they have average intelligence. That's about 70% of the population. They have average intelligence that ranges between 90 or 85 to 110 or 115. And few people are very intelligent, just as Einstein, as you see, whose intelligence was about 160. And we have a minority of people, on the other hand, whose intelligence quotient is below 70. That's to say that their intelligence is below 70% of the average intelligence expected in their age. And those people are usually referred to as the intellectually disabled. But we have one more criterion to have in these children to have their to diagnose them with intellectual disability. They must have deficits in several areas of adaptive functioning, such as communication, self-care, or interpersonal skills. The onset of the manifestation must be during the developmental period, which is age of 18. And it affects 1 to 3% of the population, with a male to female ratio of about 2 to 1. And so most of the neurodevelopmental disorders, such as intellectual disability, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and autism spectrum, they are all more prevalent in males than in females. There are many causes of intellectual disability. For example, inborn errors of metabolism, perinatal or head injuries, pierced traumas, maternal diabetes, substance abuse in the mother, such as fetal alcohol syndrome. The mother, they drink alcohol, and so the children come with intellectual disability. Some infections as well that might happen during pregnancy, like toxemia, rubella. Overall, there are more than 500 non-genetic abnormalities associated with mental retardation. The most common and famous of them is Down syndrome, which is trisomy of the chromosome 21. And we have also fragile X syndrome, which is an error that happens in the chromosome X. Some causes of intellectual disability, this is the same thing, the hypoxia, fetal alcohol syndrome, brain damage. And it's very rare to have inadequate mental stimulation or poor diet to be a cause of intellectual disability, and usually this happens in areas with war and famines and so on. And in 40% of the patients, there is no clear etiology that can be determined. Psychiatric disorders can co-occur with the intellectual disability, such as autism. We have about 50% of the people with intellectual disability. They have comorbid autism spectrum disorder. A lot of them also have ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. elimination disorders such as neurosis and incompetence, depression and anxiety, bipolar disorder, and so on. Investigations might be needed to investigate metabolic like hypothyroidism. All infants, they are screened for the thyroid functions because this is a preventable cause of intellectual disability. If we discovered the hypothyroidism or cretinism in the child, in the infant, in the first week of this, of his life or her life, we can save him or her from the fate of the intellectual disability by replacement therapy. We also screen for metabolic errors such as phenylketonuria, endocrine problems like adrenal hyperplasia, and chromosomal etiology. About one third of these kids, they have epilepsy as well, and so we might need to have electroencephalogram as well. Okay. The management, we have the management depends on the degree of impairment or retardation. Most of these children, they can develop milestones such as standing, walking, talking, and so on, but in a pattern similar to that found in normal children, but at a slower rate. They can have developmental spurs like normal children, but they couldn't be predicted at an earlier age. The mild intellectual disability, which is the majority, thank God for that, 90% of them are mild, and so they can function independently. They need what we call it mainstreaming. They have to involve them with the normal children, and they are able to hold jobs and have families of their own with a little bit more assistance than the others. The second category is a moderate ID, trainable special schools. They are trainable in special schools. They have deficits in language and motor skills. They can hold manual jobs, but need moderate supervision and support. And the severe and profound intellectual disability, they are unable to live independently, and they need usually continuous care because even the simple dangers like fire and motor accidents and so on, they cannot perceive this. They cannot understand that this is dangerous, and so they have to be under complete continuous supervision. The second disorder we are talking about is autism spectrum disorder, which is a neurodevelopmental disorder. It's a problem in the development of the brain, especially in the social brain, the centers in the brain that's responsible for the social communication. And so this child has a deficiency in the social instinct. It affects more male than female, as we said in all the neurodevelopmental disorders. One in every 150 children is on the autism spectrum. That's about 0.7 to 0.8%. Symptoms must appear before the age of 3 years old. We have usually delayed speech, social problems, problems with social communication, even the nonverbal communication like gestures, like saying bye-bye and pointing to things and so on. And we usually also have these restricted interests. They have certain interests and certain toy or certain something, and then they are playing with the same thing all the time or talking about the same thing all the time. And sometimes we have that sensory behaviors. They are intolerable to certain voices or certain sounds. They like to taste things, to smell things, to touch things in a particular way, and so on. And these are called the sensory behaviors. We can catch it early when we notice that this child doesn't point to things, doesn't smile to people, or make meaningful gestures by the age of 1 year. If he or she doesn't speak one word by the age of 16 or 18 months, if doesn't combine two words by 2 years, doesn't respond to name by the age of 1 year, and poor eye contact with people, and if he is or she is attached to one particular toy or object, that's the restricted interest we talked about in the previous slide, and at times it seems to be hearing impaired because the mother is calling his name or her name and he is not responding. But the problem here is not in the hearing. The problem is that he is not sensitive to the human voice. He is not interested in human stimuli, such as a normal child. And there is one more thing, that any regression in these children, if the child is talking some words and then he stops talking, he stops saying these words, and so we start worrying about him. Many but not all children with autism also have mental deficiency. 20 to 30% of those kids has normal or even high IQ. That's what we call high functioning autism, or HFA. Early diagnosis and social skill training is very important for these children to prevent social isolation, bullying, and subsequent academic and emotional problems. The important point here is that we say that not all autism spectrum disorder children are intellectually disabled. They might be intelligent. About 30 or even 40% of these children can talk, sometimes in a peculiar way, but they can talk and they can do well at school, and they sometimes even have excellent grades at school, but they have problems on the social aspect, and they are subjected to bullying and isolation, social isolation at schools. And this is very important to identify these kids and to give them the required care. There is no definite cause for autism spectrum disorder. Many possible causes. Genetic factors play about 60 to 70% of the etiology. There are a lot of theories about immunological factors, perinatal factors, environmental pollution, and lead and mercury poisoning, and so on, sensory deprivation. But a lot of these theories have little evidence. And also the therapeutic modalities based on these theories, they have little evidence. And we are going to talk about them after a minute. Early intervention is important. Applied behavioral analysis, that's the ABA. This is the basis of many interventions, behavioral interventions with the kids with autism. It depends on watching and analyzing the behavior of every child, and hence tailoring a specific plan for him or her. Medications are often used to treat behavioral problems such as aggression, self-injurious behavior, sensory severe tantrums, but not for the core pathology of the autism. There is no medication that targets the social communication itself, which is the main problem with the autism spectrum disorder. There is some approved medications such as risperidone and aripiprazole for the treatment of irritability and hyperactivity in autism spectrum disorder. And there are alternative unapproved interventions that's based on the theories of etiology that we talked about. For example, there is an intervention that advised we keep casein-free and gluten-free diet for these kids. And this is based on the theory that says that autism is caused by antibodies that's formed in the body against casein, which is a component of milk and milk products, and against gluten, which is a component of the wheat, and so if we kept a free diet for these kids from casein and gluten, they may improve, but there is very little evidence about this, and so we do not usually recommend that for children unless the family wants to try it. Also, hyperbaric oxygen, it's sometimes used based on the theory that the autism is caused by oxygen deficiency in the brain cells. But again, this has very little scientific evidence. Also, sometimes they do chelation for the heavy metals, and this is based on the theory that says that pollution and heavy metals like lead and mercury has an important role in the etiology of autism spectrum, and again, there is a little evidence for that. We start talking about attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, which is characterized by severe hyperactivity, impulsivity, and inability to regulate behavior in these children, and stay quiet at school or at class and pay attention to the teacher or whatever the person who gives them directions to follow. And this is actually an inherited genetic difference in the functioning of the prefrontal cortex, which is the organ responsible for the regulation of behavior. And so the development of the prefrontal cortex, there is a problem in it. And so this child has hard times regulating his behavior, keeping quiet at school when he's expected to do so, and so on. It's a very prevalent, about 3 to 7% of school-aged children. And again, male-to-female ratio is even more than in intellectual disability and autism spectrum. It's about 4 to 1. But sometimes they say that this disorder is underdiagnosed in females, and that's why we see it a lot more common in boys, because the girls are usually not that hyperactive, but they are still inattentive, and they go unnoticed, and there is no diagnosis made. ADHD run in family, genes are unknown, potential link between cigarette smoking and alcohol consumption during pregnancy and ADHD in the children. Children who have suffered a brain injury may show some behaviors similar to those of ADHD. And there was a big theory in media that sugar and food additives are causing ADHD, but this is not proven scientifically, and so there is no such thing. The three main cardinal symptoms of ADHD are inattention, hyperactivity, and impulsivity. When the child grows up and becomes an adolescent or a young man or a young woman, the impulsivity is the most important thing here, because it predisposes these kids to many other behavioral disturbances such as substance abuse, conduct disorder, criminality, and so on. Symptoms must be there before the age of 12 years old, and must be there in two settings at least, at home and at school at least, for example, or at home and in the training, in the sport club, for example. And that's why we say that we must gather information from more than one source. We are not just satisfied with what the mother says. We have to communicate with the school or the teacher or the supervisor of the child in whatever activity he practices. And we need to make sure that the behavioral pattern is present in more than one setting, not only at home. ADHD co-occurs with the oppositional defiant disorder, conduct disorder, mood disorder, and substance abuse disorders. When these children enter school, their difficulties with attention become more obvious, and they appear not to follow directions, forget important school supplies, fail to complete homework, and attempt to blurt out answers to teachers even before being called on. And because of their inattention and hyperactivity, these children often become known as the troublemakers, and sometimes we have to advise them to go to another school or another class after they get the proper treatment, because people have this memory about this child that he is a troublemaker, he is a bad guy in this class, and they cannot get rid of this image, this mental image in the minds of other people. The most common type of medication used for treating ADHD is called a stimulant, and this might appear as a little bit weird, because these children are hyperactive. How come we are giving them a stimulant? And the answer here is that the stimulant will stimulate the prefrontal cortex that will keep them quiet. And so the prefrontal cortex has that function of regulating the behavior. And when we stimulate this part of the brain, we give more attention and less activity, to less motor activity and less impulsivity to this child, because actually this is the function of the prefrontal cortex. We have few other ADHD medications which are not stimulants, such as atomoxetine, and behavioral therapy can help a child monitor and change his or her behavior. The oppositional defiant disorder is some extreme form of the usual stubbornness of the children. It's not unusual for children to defy authority and to be disobedient to the father or mother or teacher and so on. But when this behavior become very excessive compared to what's usual, it may mean that this child has ODD, oppositional defiant disorder. And when things become worse, we call it conduct disorder. When this adolescent start deceiving people, lying to his parents, stealing for money from home or outside home, distracting the properties of others, or aggressive, very aggressive to people or animals, or serious violations of rules of home or school or whatever, this is called conduct disorder. It is a disruptive, violent behavior in which the basic rights of others are violated. Is lying a basic a violation for the basic rights of the other? Yes, it is, because it's the right of people to know the truth. And when you lie to people, you violate this right. You violate their right to know the truth. Okay, and this is very, very dangerous and disorder, and very difficult disorder to treat. And sometimes we have to admit these children and the adolescent to the inpatient unit to control their behavior and to have a very strict and intensive program to modify this behavior. We need also parent management, family therapy. We need to talk to the parents and tell them how to deal with these children. We apply what's called problem-solving techniques with the child. This is a sort of cognitive therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy. As we said, we might need inpatient care, and medications are used only to treat a comorbid ADHD or mood disorder. Some antipsychotics or mood stabilizers, such as risperidone or lithium, might be helpful to control the aggression and the impulsivity in these kids. Anxiety. We have anxiety in children. It's expected and normal at specific times, such as the separation anxiety, the separation from parents. So it causes some anxiety at the age between 8 months or 5 years of age. But if this anxiety is excessive, if it prevents the child from going to school or playing sports and so on, it's called a disorder. And also generalized anxiety disorder and panic disorder and all other anxiety disorders, it happens in children and it's prevalent in children. Sometimes we have depression in the children, which may present in the form of persistent sadness, somatic complaints, or disruptive behavior that interferes with normal social activities, interests, or schoolwork. Some children have extreme changes in mood, energy, thinking, or behavior, and a few of those will have bipolar disorder, which is a more severe form of mood disorders and is associated with more rates of self-injurious behavior and suicidal behavior. Teenagers experience strong feelings of stress, confusion, or self-doubt. They might have suicidal thoughts, and they may actually have suicidal attempts. And in the USA, suicide is the third leading cause of death for youth between 15 and 24 years old, and the sixth leading cause of death in those between 5 and 14 years old. And this tells us that this is a serious problem, and we have to take it very seriously. When a child or adolescent talks about this or talks about hurting himself or herself, and we can deal with that with several types of psychotherapy, especially the cognitive behavioral therapy. There is forms of the CBT that's made especially for children and adolescents to be easy for them. And also we have many drugs, mainly antidepressants and mood stabilizers, are available to deal or to use in this age category. The take-home message here is that children and adolescents do suffer from psychiatric disorders, and they need our help. Thank you, and this is my contact information. If you need to contact me, you can email me on this university email, and you can also watch this lecture and other videos on my channel on the YouTube called Dr. Muhammad Salim. Thank you, and see you in another lectures, and that's it for today. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.